So, excellent. So, welcome to the opening talk of the historical seminar series. This is a series that's organized by Vinod, Tal, and I. And the aim of the series is to present the seminal papers that helped shape and define the field and really move it forward. The talks will discuss not only the results, but also the historical context in which these results came about, and how they shape the field and how they're going to, or how they have been shaping the field and influencing the field, and what influence they'll have going forward. So maybe some predictions for the future as well. We have a great lineup, so we'll have Ron Rivest speaking today. We have a break for the next 2 weeks. So next week there'll be the multi-party computation workshop. The week after is the week of stocks, so we won't have a talk. Then we have Umesh Vazirani, Russell Impagliazzo, Daniele Miciancio, Dan Bonet, Shafi Goldwasser, Hugo Kravchik, Victor Shoup, and Eyal Koshilevit. So wonderful lineup. You'll get emails. And Cynthia. Sorry, forgot. Cynthia Dwork. So wonderful lineup. You will get emails about all of these. So there's really no better way to kick off this historical series than with Ron Rivest. So probably all of you know Ron Rivest. He needs no introduction, but Ron is the Vannevar Bush Professor of Electrical Engineering and Computer Science at MIT. Of course, we're all familiar with his work. He's the R and the RSA crypto system, the R and the RC4 stream cipher. He's the designer of the MD5 hash. All of these are prevalent crypto systems that we're using today. And he's also worked on many other areas of cryptography, the first works defining digital signatures, the idea of fully homomorphic encryption, and more recently on secure voting as well. Some of you might have also learned algorithms from Ron's book, the CLR or CLRS algorithms book. He's the recipient of the Turing Award and the Kobayashi Award, among many others. He's the member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the National Academy of Engineering, the National Academy of Sciences, the ACM Fellow, and an ICR Fellow. So without further ado,
on now. You hear me? Okay, good.
It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you to the organizers for... I just lost it. Oh, yeah. Thought I'd get away with it.
Let's try it again. Good? Yes. All right, good. So it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks to the organizers for inviting me. It's a great program set here for the summer. I'm looking forward to participating throughout as much as I can for the summer. I'll be here for a total of about a month. But broken up. I guess this may be the kickoff lecture for the historical paper series, too. Some reminiscences about RSA and the history of crypto. The title, excuse for a couple of things, I guess the title is a bit pretentious. It's mostly idiosyncratic about things I was involved in and things, my perspective on some of the things I got involved in. As you know, the field is huge and there's lots and lots of wonderful history, and I think the series is great to bring that out and forward. This is also a talk that was designed for a broad audience, so I know many of you are really experts in this field, and some of the historical anecdotes may be of interest, but the technical content is going to be lightweight, and there's no theorems proved here or anything like that. So it's that kind of a talk. So I should have a clicker here somewhere. So we'll talk about some. So this is historical. So I'm going to start way back, some pre-76 context about the development of RSA, some of the early steps of development of crypto in the 70s, a little bit about the crypto business, RSA company, about crypto policy, attacks on various crypto systems, something about directions, where's the field going, maybe some speculations, conclusions. So that's the outline, the menu for today. So since this is the historical paper series, I thought we should start way back. So Euclid said there's infinitely many primes, 300 BC, nice proof that that's the case, and that turns out to be a useful fact for crypto, as we all know. And in fact, primes are reasonably dense, so you can generate and test for them. First algorithm is allegedly the GCD algorithm. So being able to find the GCD of 12 and 30 and getting 6, we can do that easily. So if we're going to have a historical seminar series, I think we should start with the Greeks and talk about not only their mathematics, but also their crypto. So they had this device called the Skitali, which was basically a cylinder of unknown, at least to the adversary, unknown diameter, where you wrap the message around it. And so it had an unknown period. You write the message on, then you unravel the strip and show it to your, or give it to your courier to take to the correspondent, and you could take another stick of the same diameter, wrap it around, and you can read the message. So, kill the king tomorrow midnight is the message here. Having things with unknown periods is actually a recurrent theme in crypto, as we see with RSA later on and other schemes, and even quantum computing. So this idea of having an unknown period and that being the secret is actually a key insight. Well, moving right along, Pierre de Fermat, amateur mathematician in the 1600s, discovered but did not prove that if you have a prime number p and some number a between 1 and p, that a to the p minus 1 gives you 1 back. So this is well known. So he did lots of things, writing in margins and such, but this he didn't prove. But the follow-on to this was Euler's theorem. So Euler was perhaps the greatest mathematician of his generation in the 1700s. And he generalized this fact by Fermat and proved it properly. So Euler's theorem says that if we have an n, arbitrary n, not necessarily prime, doesn't have to be a prime p, and a number a that's relatively prime to n, then a to the phi of n is equal to 1 mod n, where phi of n is just the size of the multiplicative group mod n, or it's a number of x that are GCD of x and n is 1, plus between 1 and n. So this turns, again, as we all know, turns out to be useful. We have, any time you get the identity back in crypto, that's a useful thing to observe, because when you encrypt and you decrypt, you get the same thing back, and so that's a way of getting the identity. So getting the identity back is in non-trivial ways, is useful. So then there was Gauss. Gauss, arguably the greatest mathematician of all time, although you can debate that, published at age 21 his Disquisitionis Arithmeticae, in which he said that the problem of distinguishing prime numbers from composite numbers and of resolving the latter into their prime factors is known to be one of the most important and useful in arithmetic. The dignity of science itself seems to require a solution of a problem so elegant and so celebrated. I know Lynn Edelman likes this quote a lot, too. It's a great quote. Actually, he doesn't get it quite right here, right? I mean, this isn't one problem. This is two problems, right? He talks about, on the one hand, telling prime numbers from non-prime numbers, and on the other hand, factoring of composite numbers into their prime factors. And as it turns out, and as we all know, those problems are actually, or seem to be, very different in terms of their computational complexity. And so telling whether something is a prime or not is easy. Telling whether it's telling if that it's composite is easy, but telling if it's composite what the prime factors are seems to be hard. So Gauss seemed to conflate those two here, although who knows what he actually thought. He had lots of cool ideas, not all of which got written down. So this is a guy you probably haven't heard of, Stanley Jevons, but it's a fellow that I like quite a bit. You'll see why. He was an economist, a mathematician. He wrote something called The Principles of Science back in 1874. He was very interested in the economics of coal and has a principle named after him called the Jevons Principle, which says that if you make a resource, if you are able to utilize a resource more efficiently, you use more of it. At that time, they were very much worried about the coal economy in Britain and running out of coal and things like this. And so people were worried about better ways to utilize coal, and he said, well, if you make coal usage more efficient, you're just going to use more of it, which something to think about when we're talking about oil conservation, things like that today. Anyway, that's all beside the point. What interests him to me is the fact that he was the first person to publish a factoring challenge. So he, in his book, he says, what two numbers multiplied together will produce 861-646-0799? Right, so that's a 10-digit number like a phone number, right? And he says, I think it's unlikely that anyone but myself will ever know. Right. And talking about phones, this is the kind of number these days you could factor on your smartphone, right? It's not that hard a number. But in fact, he was right. During his lifetime, nobody factored this number. He posed it as a hard problem. I mean, he understood that there were hard problems and easy problems. And so this is a hard problem. So was factored in only in 1903, 89681 times 96079. You can check that on your smartphone, right? By Lamer, who was Lamer was here at Berkeley, right? He was, wasn't he? Maybe Dick knows. It was, yeah, he was here, right? Yeah. I think he had this device with bicycle chains and so on, too, for doing factoring of numbers in various periods and so on. It was kind of cool. But I don't think that's what he used for this. So then we move on, again, in setting the historical context for cryptography. One of the big things that really happened to this field is the invention of radio, right? Marconi in the late 1800s was able to demonstrate transatlantic communication. Radio made a huge difference in cryptography because it made a need for cryptography. Once you could communicate with your armies and your ships overseas, you know, you've got a broadcast channel. Anybody can listen in. Secrecy is no longer the default. Secrecy is something you have to work hard to get at. And so cryptography became popular. Not good cryptography, but you know, attempts at cryptography became popular then. And code books of various sorts saying, you know, this word should be encoded this way, and that word should be encoded that way. You know, variable keys were not really thought of that much, but just code books. Radio made a need for cryptography, and cryptography started becoming of wider interest during the early 1900s. In fact, during the First World War and the build-up to it, cryptography played a key role getting the United States into World War I, because the decipherment by the British of the Zimmermann telegram, in which the Germans promised a big piece of the U.S. to Mexico, if Mexico would help the Germans with their goals of keeping the U.S. out of the war. So that was a scandal that made World War I inevitable, and the U.S. involvement in World War I inevitable. So after the war, Turing started developing the foundations of our field, and so many of you know the story here already if you've seen the movie The Imitation Game, which to my taste isn't too bad. It gets most of the history right, some of it not quite so right, but you know, the important part for us is the foundations of the theory of computability, right? Computers in the abstract didn't exist, in the real world didn't exist much. In the abstract, they did. He invented the Turing machine, the idea of computability. The fact that computers couldn't do some things was interesting, novel, and important for the field. It's actually an interesting test for our computer science curriculum as to whether you can get through the MIT curriculum without having been taught what the halting problem is undecidable or not. I think you can, actually, but it's a shame that anybody should get through an MIT computer science degree without knowing that fact for sure. Not that many students do, but I think it is possible. So that's the first thing that Turing did. But the second thing, he worked on crypto, and as some of the stuff is still being known, that this was released not too long ago, the applications of probability to cryptography, declassified. You look at it and you wonder why it was ever classified. Actually, there's actually not much in this particular document of interest, but the British Library has decided to declassify some of his works. So during the war, Enigma machines were used by the Germans to communicate. And these are wonderful devices. I don't know if you've ever seen one up close, but just the structure of them is really quite complicated. We talk about cryptography wanting to be simple. Algorithms should be simple. This is a complicated device. It grew out of a long history of rotor machines by Hagelin and others of Swiss design. This has three rotors here, and some of the other designs had four. And every time a letter was enciphered, these rotors would turn in odometer fashion. The outermost one here would turn one step, and then every time once around, the next one would turn one step, and so on. And these rotors implemented permutation, so there was wiring going through these rotors. The front side and the back side of the rotor were connected in a random manner, and so the current would flow through the first rotor, through the second rotor, through the third rotor, and came back through the rotors. And you press a key here, the current goes through the rotors, back through, and lights up a light. There's also a plug board here, too, which is interposed in the circuit as well, which pairs letters together. So it's a complicated design. It's got mechanical state. It's not really a computer, but it's a digital device of enormous complexity, really. I mean, I think one of the exercises I'd like to do would be to maybe over the January IEP that we have at MIT is just to see what a bunch of MIT students could do trying to break this over the period of a month or something like this. It's highly non-trivial. And nonetheless, it was broken, if you've seen the movie or know your history. In other words, Turing and others at Bletchley Park broke this using a combination of mathematics, observations about the machine. For example, the fact that this machine never encrypts a letter as itself is a very useful property if you're trying to break it. The fact that the current has to go in and then come back out again a different port means it'll never encrypt the letter as itself. So this involved the building of the first programmable digital devices of our era. The Colossus machines used to break. These were fascinating devices. There's now a wonderful park at Bletchley Park, a wonderful museum at Bletchley Park, where they have a working one of these gadgets. And you saw it in the movie if you've seen The Imitation Game. If you haven't seen The Imitation, go see it. But you can see it working the machine, all these things searching through the key space. So many of the people involved in the early days of our field, the field of computer science, were involved here, and they saw the promise of digital technology, the promise of programmable devices, the promise of digital computers, as it were, and many of the early computers then sprang out of efforts of those people involved in this effort to build commercially useful devices. One of the people that was involved in the code-breaking effort at that time was Shannon. He talked with Turing. He was at Bell Labs at the time. He came to MIT later as a faculty member. He wrote one of the first theory papers about crypto, the communication theory of secrecy systems. This is not what Shannon is best known for, as you probably know, right? He's best known for his work in error-correcting codes, and that was done about the same time. This work was delayed because of classification requirements by the U.S. government. And then he proved that the one-time pad is unconditionally secure. Excuse me a second. Let me... So moving on in the context here. So crypto was from World War II until the 60s, almost entirely a classified effort done in military agencies, and very little discussion or academic interest was apparent at the time until about the 60s when David Kahn wrote this wonderful book called The Codebreakers. And if you haven't seen that, I recommend it to you. It's a broad history of cryptography from the Egyptians to the modern era. It's a big book, I don't know, 900 pages or something like that. David Kahn is a journalist and historian, very much interested in World War II in particular, but cryptography in general. I think many of the early academic cryptographers cut their teeth on this in some ways, reading through the history of cryptography, what worked, what didn't, and what kinds of techniques were used. Cryptography wasn't a formalized field then. There were many things tried, many things broken. In some ways, it's like it's still what we have today. In many ways, we're seeing a lot of things tried and broken, but often it's the proofs that are found to be, you know, having a gap or don't cover all the cases. The NSA attempted to suppress the publication of this. That's an issue we still see today. You know, what's the role of cryptography in society? Should it be out and used widely? And of course, my own personal belief is that we need this to run our information-based society. That's subject of debate, as we'll see later. The FBI keeps arguing that, you know, crypto and commercial devices is a bad thing. Moving on to the 70s, there was finally enough activity in the commercial sphere to, and both in the computation side and the communication side, for the need for cryptography to start becoming apparent. And so the National Bureau of Standards, which is now called NIST, put out a call for encryption algorithms. And at first, they got no suppliers at all. Nobody wanted to submit an encryption algorithm to be evaluated for a U.S. government standard. Or at least the ones that were submitted were not of any quality, apparently. And so they put out a second call saying, let's do this right, guys. Come on, let's have a submission or two that's actually worth something. And so IBM put a team together, and it was led by Horst Feistel, who lived at the Cape Cod for many years. And he proposed a couple of designs, one of which was published in Scientific American. And this is a design that actually got adopted, the data encryption standard, which many of you know because of its Feistel structure, as it's called now. This ladder-like structure has wonderful flexibility. It allows any plain text up here to be encrypted to a ciphertext by a sequence of rounds. In each round, the left half is modified by exclusive ORing it with some function that's a keyed function of the right side, and the left and right sides are swapped. It says the marvelous property that it's always invertible no matter what F is, and so you can design F to have the cryptographic properties that you think it should have. The status of this design is apparently that the NSA persuaded IBM to submit a design having at most having exactly 56 bits. I mean, it actually has 64 bits, but 8 of them were parity bits, so they don't really count. All right, so 56-bit keys in return for somewhat unspecified help in the design of the F function. And in fact, the assistance that NSA allegedly gave to IBM at the time helped make the data encryption standard secure against differential attacks, which were unknown in the public domain at the time. And so this design was adopted as a national standard and is still in wide use in some banking applications, mostly as in triple encryption mode, though where it doesn't have a 56-bit key, but a much longer key. Computational complexity. So Turing laid the foundation saying, you know, some things are computable, some things are not. The next question is, you know, well, how much resources are required to compute something? And so Hartmanis, Stearns, Blum, Cook, and Karp laid the foundations for computational complexity as we know it today, asking not is it computable, but if it's computable, how much does it take? How much resources does it take? How much time does it take? How much space does it take? And so this suite of results gave the right definitions for what it meant to be a resource for a computation, to talk about exponential time, polynomial time. The notion of polynomial time became codified and understood as being the most important one for sort of practical computation. The notion of NP completeness, which Dick and others explored to great extent, became the sort of foundation for what we understand most hard practical problems to be like. I mean, in practice, most problems are either polynomial time or they're NP complete, a few are in between. Sometimes you had exponential, but that's rare. So this is the right set of notions for cryptography. You want to have a notion of hardness because the adversary is going to be faced with computational problems that you want to be arguably hard, and you want to have reductions, if you can, from hard problems or problems believed to be hard to the computations that the adversary has to do in order to show that the adversary is not going to be able to break your scheme easily. So NP completeness per se has not turned out to be as useful as we might like for crypto, because crypto is tends to have unique solutions and things like this. But this laid the framework for the development of the field. And at the time, in the late 70s, when crypto really started expanding, the approach, the style of asking about a problem, how hard is this problem? Is this polynomial time? Is it exponential time? Trying to classify problems is precisely the kind of work you need to do to do cryptography. You need to have an argument that the problems are easy for the good guys and that they're hard for the bad guys. So you want to put them on the complexity scale. National public key crypto. So in the 70s, Ralph Merkle was here at Berkeley writing a class project for a security class in which he proposed a process by which two parties could end up communicating secretly over a channel which was not secret. And in his eventual paper, this was accomplished by a sequence of puzzles that Alice would make, or one party would send up and send to the other, and then one of them would be solved and the solution sent back and so on too. Interestingly, the faculty member who was teaching the class didn't appreciate the idea very much, and so Ralph went off to Stanford and talked with Whit Diffie and Marty Hellman, who had independently been working on ideas of this sort. The idea of, it's not quite key exchange, but public key cryptography, where each party has a key that's published and can be used for encryption to that party. But independently, the trio of them established the notion of public key cryptography as something which might be doable. This resulted in a paper by Diffie and Hellman, New Directions in Cryptography, which starts off with this wonderful sentence: we are at the brink of a revolution in cryptography, which is sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy here. They really caused, in many, to much extent, that this revolution by proposing ideas which the rest of us have all followed up on.
How do you explain that they knew?
I was directly motivated by their paper.
How did they know that it was going to be a brink of a revolution?
How did they know it? Good question. I'm glad you're asking questions, by the way. Feel free to ask questions anytime. Maybe they didn't know. Maybe they were just predicting. I mean, it was just, speculating, hoping.
But this is a huge statement.
This is a huge statement to make.
I hope you can say I have a few followers.
Yeah. Yeah. But the paper really, if you read the paper, it really is inspirational. It says, there is a field here. There is a need for this kind of stuff. There is prospects for a technology that can handle some of the questions that come up. It wasn't vacuous or just presumptuous. They really said, there's some real new ideas here. We don't know how to complete them all, but there's you can hope to be able to talk to your stockbroker, privately or other things, or do digital signatures. The idea of digital signatures was in this paper, and that really was the thing that got me going when I saw this. This paper was given to me by a graduate student. He said, "Ron, you might find this paper interesting," and I said, "Yeah, that's it." And I got Adi and Len to work on it. They really left it as an open problem, right? This was they don't know how to implement this. So, the idea, as many of you have seen, is the classic idea of public key crypto is a one-way permutation, right? So every party's got a public key. It implements a one-way permutation of the message space to the ciphertext space. So you can encrypt a message M by applying the public key of the recipient, obtaining a ciphertext, and then the counterparty has the corresponding decryption key, which is implemented as the inverse permutation. Easy to compute matching and secret pairs. And this is the way they framed the problem. And the key complexity notion is that publishing one of the keys, the public key, doesn't destroy the secrecy, doesn't reveal the secret key somehow. So it's computationally infeasible. So we have this notion of computational complexity coming in right at the start here of the field. Computationally infeasible to obtain the secret key from the public key. So you can list the public key in a directory, and that was as far as their ideas about public key infrastructure went, was a public directory, like a thing that we've seen since how hard PKIs are, and getting that right. We're still working on making that work properly, but the idea of a directory listing somehow names and public keys together started off here as well. So that was the idea. This is what they said. We ought to be able to do this. Moreover, and this is the thing that I found the most exciting personally, was the idea of digital signatures. Right? They said you ought to be able to use this public key framework to create digital signatures. And so we just turn things around. We'll sign with the secret key and we'll verify with the public key. And in the same way, using these as one-way permutations, so I can, if I'm the signer, if I'm A, I can take the message and apply the secret key to it that permutes the message space to obtain the signature sigma, and then anybody can verify, given the signature sigma and the public key for me, to obtain the message back. And so if that checks, that's the verification condition for a digital signature. And this is a inadequate definition by modern standards, but it's a start on the idea of a digital signature. It's inadequate because you can obviously create matching message signature pairs, even if they're nonsense, by encrypting something with the public key. These are just inverse permutations. But it's a start, and it's the open problem the way they formulated it then. And at the time when they published the paper, we didn't know how to do this at all, right? This was not a solved problem. This was an idea. And they said, if we can solve, we can implement this, then we can not only have confidentiality, we can have authenticity, we can have digital signatures. And they talked at length about that, and they had some ideas and directions for how things we might explore for doing public key cryptography, including things like program obfuscation, which maybe you've never gone back and looked at that paper, right? They've got a nice section at the end talking about taking circuits and obfuscating them so you can't tell what they're computing anymore, which is very resonant with today's research, right? I mean, that's very interesting. So they didn't see how to completely implement. They had some ideas that were relevant, but they were So then, as I said, a graduate student gave me the paper, and I got Adi and Lynn to look at this too. It's a picture taken about that time. We had offices near each other in the Tech Square at the time, and basically the style of work we had is that Adi and I were generating ideas and Lynn trying to say, well, how do we implement these kinds of things? And Lynn would break them. And after a while, Lynn would be successful so often that Adi and I would get discouraged if we tried to argue, well, this idea just can't work at all. It should be impossible to do public. You know, we'd think about that for a while, and then we'd give up on that and go back to thinking about other things. This picture is interesting, too, because we wrote a joke on here for the photographers. Therefore, P equals NP, you know. So. Of course, the photographer didn't know anything. So, you know, we had ideas that seemed to work. Adi had one idea he claimed when we were skiing once. We went up to Killington and went skiing. And if you've ever been skiing with Adi, this is what he looks like when he's skiing. This is not a picture of Adi, but he's a madman on the slopes, right? And so he was skiing. So he remembers solving the problem on one downhill run. He says, I got the idea. Then we got to the bottom. He couldn't remember it anymore. So. Don't go skiing with Adi unless you're very, very good. He's a terror on the hill. Here's another idea that we see people asking, what kind of ideas did you think about? Here's an idea that was actually pretty close to the final sort of thing. So one idea we kept puzzling over was this idea of having a cycle of sort of one-way permutations going around so that you can have some one-way permutation F with unknown trapdoor period P, and you apply F T times and you get over here, and then you apply it U more times to get back, and you choose T and U so that T plus U is P, and F to the T has to be easily computed and F to the U has to be easily computed, and you encrypt by applying F T times and you decrypt by applying it U more times. So you can't go backwards because it's one way, but you can go forwards any amount as long as you know the amount. If you don't know how long the period is, you can't get back. So that was one idea we noodled over. This is not quite RSA, right? This is. I mean, you can sort of cast RSA in this model, but it doesn't fit quite so naturally. RSA is a little different than this, but it you can see where it's close. We also looked at a lot of other things, knapsack-based things and so on, too, that we couldn't see how not to break. I mean, it was... We keep talking about this intensely. You know how research goes. You keep talking, and that's why a meeting like this is great, right? Everybody's together, and you're talking. In vino veritas, as Pliny said, right? So there was a Seder dinner, and Pliny said first, I think, AD 50, in wine there is truth, and a little Beneshevitz wine, some permutation polynomials, just the factoring, and finally we came up with the idea for the RSA method, per se, right? So... And as you know, RSA depends on the inability of factoring a product of two primes P and Q, giving you N. The public key is N and the exponent. E has to satisfy this condition. And D is, secret key is just D, where D times E is 1 mod phi of N. So this is well known, and the equations for encryption and decryption nicely fit on a T-shirt if you can. So that's the RSA method. So that was the proposal. We had no idea at the time whether it would be secure or not, or whether it would work. In particular, this factoring problem was not one that we could find much literature on. It was not a well-studied problem. It was an arcane problem that was studied by a few, you know, guys who were working on various kinds of special numbers or other things. And it was not a problem with much history or from a computational viewpoint. Then Rich Chappelle had some ideas. Some of the folks in the number theory community had some approaches for numbers, but it did seem like it was likely to be hard. And we couldn't find anything that said it was easy. And if you make the numbers big enough, it seemed likely to be hard. And it didn't matter here how big the numbers were, and it still doesn't. I mean, you can take the numbers as big as you need to. So it seemed plausible. So we tried to find out how hard factoring was. And so factoring, as I said, was this arcane sort of thing. So one of the people, we talked to lots of people trying to find out what they knew about factoring. And one of the people we talked to was Martin Gardner, because he was the kind of guy who collects all kinds of oddball things about mathematics and wrote about them in his column. If you've ever seen his column, you should go back to it. I mean, his columns are really an inspiration for a whole generation of computer scientists. And they're collected now, and you can buy them. All kinds of wonderful problems. And I recommend just buying a couple of his books, of his collected articles, if you haven't seen them, because they're an inspiration. Everything from hexaflexagons to all kinds of weird graph problems. And then he wrote a column about RSA. We asked him about factoring. He said, why are you interested in that? And so we talked to him. And he said, oh, I want to write a column about that. So the kangaroo issue of Scientific American in his column, which is called Mathematical Games, had an article about RSA. And so we did a couple things in that article. We described it to him, gave him some examples he could use. And we said, if anybody wants technical details more than you can put in your article, we'll send happy to send people a copy of our technical memo if they send us a stamped self-addressed envelope. And we're so brazen as to offer more than Jevons did. Jevons never offered any money for his factoring challenge. We actually put a challenge in Scientific American with a $100 prize. So 129-digit product of primes, which we thought would be plenty big enough. We did some estimations based on some formulas that Rich Chappelle had made for his quadratic sieve method, which I think we miscalculated a bit. Not only was the algorithm not the best algorithm that was going to be known, but also I think we just made a mistake in the estimation of how long it would take. So we estimated 40 quadrillion years to factor that number. We never expected it to be factored. And you know the story, but we'll get into that. So that was published there as well. And we published our memo and then the paper in CACM. This is the memo that we had promised people to. This is from the Lab for Computer Science. We promised people we'd mail it out. Actually, there was a delay in getting it out because various allegations were raised by lawyers at the NSA or other places saying, it's illegal to submit this stuff. Disseminating research about cryptography is against the International Traffic in Arms Regulation. You're an arms manufacturer, or you're violating the law. And so we didn't know. We're not lawyers. So we went to the MIT lawyers and said, can you tell us what's proper? And they took quite a few months to answer that question. In the meanwhile, we're getting more and more self-addressed stamped envelopes piling up at our lab, people wanting copies of the memo. And finally, in December, a couple months later, the lawyer said, there's an exemption for academic research. You don't need to worry about this. So we bought a lot of pizza for the graduate students and had them stuff on, technical memos into the envelopes and send it out. And nothing ever happened. We never went to jail for that. So. Alice and Bob, things come and go in crypto, but this is one of the contributions of our paper that I think will last even if RSA folds down, right? So Alice and Bob made their first appearance in the RSA paper, right? And that was an expository device to be a, cryptography is many ways about people doing things, right? So you need to have some names for the people. It's nice to have a he and a she, so you can have some the different pronouns to make it clear, and the A and the B to go together. So those turned out to be a very useful expository device. So Alice can send her public key over to Bob, and Bob can encrypt something and send it back to Alice. So you've all seen these diagrams. But the existence of Al and Bob, they first appeared in the RSA paper, and now they're everywhere. I was at a hotel once not too long ago, and what's the name of the science guy? Neil deGrasse Tyson was talking about. Pardon? Neil deGrasse Tyson's the guy I'm thinking of. Yeah, not Bill Nye. Yeah. And he was talking about Alice falling into the black hole while Bob is watching, and Alice and Bob have been through a lot together, but they started here. Been married, divorced, bought houses together, had secret contracts, and done all kinds of stuff. They have lots of crypto papers. They have an XKCD. If you look at the XKCD, you'll find, and they've got their own Wikipedia page and stuff like that, too. So good for Alice and Bob. It turns out that the idea of public key cryptography was independently invented by the British intelligence system. Not in the U.S., but the Brits did it. James Ellis, Clifford Cox, and Malcolm Williamson invented this apparently a few years before Diffie-Hellman and Merkle came up and before the RSA work. And they had the ideas of public key cryptography, the RSA algorithm, and the Diffie-Hellman key exchange there. But they didn't know what to do with it, or didn't fit into their organization or something. For some reason, it just sort of sat there. One interesting fact is it seems that they never came up with the idea of digital signatures. Right, that's something that the outside world did that was not done first in the classified world. So the idea of a digital signature, which, as I said, the thing that got me most interested in the public key thing, was apparently not done there. But anyway, they deserve credit for also thinking up these ideas. Early steps. So what happened then? So the idea was out. We have implementation, a prototype implementation. What can you do with public key crypto? One of the important steps forward was an MIT bachelor's thesis done by Lauren Kohnfelder. Lauren Kohnfelder wrote a bachelor's thesis called, what's the title of it? Towards a Practical Public Key Crypto System, supervised by Len, and in 1978. He proposed the idea of a digital certificate, right? So that's what we all have now in our browsers. You have a certificate that's an attestation by some authority saying that this public key belongs to that person. So we're replacing the idea of a phone book, matching names and public keys, by the idea of a certificate, which has just one data entry for that from that phone book signed by an authoritative party. So that idea first appeared here, and so the PKI work really originated in a bachelor's thesis. So here's another thing that maybe not too well known. One of the things that people wondered about when they heard about RSA was, all those numbers, they're huge. How can you possibly work with numbers that are, you know, 50 or 100 digits long or whatever? And at that time, it was sort of true that the numbers were hard. I mean, the kind of computer that we had on our desks in the 70s compared to what you have now, they're about a million times faster now, right? I mean, they're really much more capable. Dealing with big numbers then was hard. And so we had to make an effort to convince people that it was actually practical to deal with large numbers. So one of the ways of dealing with hard computational problems now, then and now is just to build special purpose hardware. So one of the things we did was to build an RSA chip at the time. So at that time, VLSI was very much in a transition phase from the old school, where we actually had people come and teach us from the industry about how you make chips. And the way you did it was you take a big sheet of red cellophane and scissors, and you cut out the cellophane into the form of the mask you want. You lay that down, and that's a picture's taken of that. And that's how you get your masks for your thing. So I took a class where we did this kind of cutting and stuff like this. That's not how we designed this chip, however. So this chip, you know, then DARPA got in the game. I think it was called ARP at the time, and said, we want to support VLSI research. Do you have any interesting projects? It says, fine, we'll build an RSA chip. So we actually wrote Lisp code that generated all the wires and the transistors here and everything. So this was a fun project. And it had a 512-bit bignum processor, did RSA key generation, including prime finding and GCD, even had Pollard's row factorization all built. There's a whole bunch of microcode in here that does all that. 40,000 transistors. The wires were 4 microns wide. Now you can get wires that are, what, 10 microns? What's the current technology? 14 microns, maybe? Something like that with current technology. So this is 1,000 times fatter than it would be today. But it came back and it didn't work, and we didn't have the tools to debug it. At the digital level, it simulated fine. It was a beautiful design, worked great. But the memory cells seemed to have some flakiness too. That these days one would wonder whether they might have been sabotaged or not. Who knows? It could, you read the Snowden revelations, the kind of things that the NSA is up to now. It's exactly the kind of thing they would have done if they were doing that kind of thing. Then maybe they did. Who knows? But anyway, it never worked. But so we tabled that and went on to look at other things. One of the things I was involved with is establishment of the International Association for Cryptologic Research. So David Chaum was one of the visionaries who helped get this going. I was involved in the start of this, so you're all familiar with this now. It runs the crypto conferences, it runs Eurocrypt, it runs AsiaCrypt, has a hand in chess and PKI, PKC, and so on. All the standard crypto conferences. One of the nice things about this field is the community it's established, and a lot of that's housed in this association, right? This association does a great job of supporting and running the conferences for the community. And I think it's a great professional community compared to some of the others I've seen in other fields. It really works well. They have their usual issues. I mean, every year at the business meeting at Crypto, the question comes up as to whether the conference should again be held in Santa Barbara, and that's a unanimous vote. Yes, we should have the conference again in Santa Barbara. Or whether we should have parallel sessions, maybe this year. Or should the submissions be blind or not? And that gets a lot of debate. And the question, which I think may be becoming more important, is whether ICR should take a stand on some of the policy issues that are coming up, whether cryptographic research and the use of cryptography ought to be something that the ICR should speak up on in terms of government policy. And we'll talk maybe a little bit more about that. But that's so far they've been primarily neutral on that issue. So RSA didn't have strong theoretical foundations, right? There was factoring was clearly, the difficulty of factoring was clearly a necessary assumption. If you could factor the modulus, the scheme is broken. But there wasn't a clean tie between an assumption and the difficulty of breaking the problem. So Sylvia and Shafi, who were here at the time doing their graduate work, developed the notions of probabilistic encryption and the notion of semantic security, and tied together with the right definitions and the right notions, these ideas of cryptographic security with the assumptions that underlie them, you need to make to make it hold, quadratic residuosity, say, or something else. And one of the necessary consequences of their work was the insight that encryption to be secure really needs to be randomized. And I think this was a hard thing for many people to, including me, actually, at the time, to accept. Sort of say, well, yeah, randomizing, you pay a lot for randomization, right? First of all, you have to have some way of generating random bits. More then your ciphertext gets longer because you've got more entropy to encode and so on and so forth. So it's not obviously worthwhile. It just sort of feels inefficient somehow at the beginning. And I think that was one of the problems we had in the 80s was making that transition to randomized encryption schemes. The Elgamal scheme was proposed in the 80s as well, which was necessarily randomized and also did not see a quick uptake in its use. And I think part of the reason was the difficulty of getting randomization. So there's a conceptual step forward that Sylvia and Shafi made, eventually became the obvious truth as we all understand it now. Yeah, this should be randomized. This stuff should be randomized. But it took a while. Yeah.
Historic question. So, yeah. Of course, public encryption is like super cool because you know you don't have this key distribution problem. Mm-hmm. But symmetric encryption, somehow, you know, you started with the channel symmetric encryption. You mentioned that, but you kind of sidestep what was happening to symmetric encryption in the meanwhile.
Yes. So I was not so much involved in that. I mean, there was some modes of operation that were.
Adequately developed. You know, was encryption schemes used kind of. Secure, were people using symmetric encryption? It was kind of
so the use was, I mean, people started using symmetric encryption. I mean, DES got used widely.
But they didn't have modes of operation.
It was modes of operation.
You need to randomize encryption, or yep. At least some nonce even for symmetric key. And it's kind of one of those things that kind of Phil Rogoway, well, not complained, but in quotes, kind of said that it was kind of strange that at MIT in this academic cryptography, for whatever reason, despite having you at MIT, seems to kind of ignore anything with symmetric stuff, despite its widespread use and relevance. Was it true that academics kind of cared, in particular modes of operation, I'm curious. Where did
it wasn't, there wasn't much of that at MIT, that's correct.
But did people know that you need to use modes of operation, that IDs shouldn't be reused? I mean,
so people, academics, I think, understood that. I think it was the theoretical questions were felt to be less interesting there at the time, maybe. I don't know.
First papers kind of come in like 1999 or so. I mean, like,
yes, later.
Particular modes of operation, I'm curious. When I write symmetric papers, I don't know whom to...
Yeah.
Modes of operation was.
It was all sort of ad hoc at the time. I mean, there was little theory at first. People were developing things to use without theoretical foundations first. So there's a lot of ideas about how one might do these things, a lot of bad ideas about modes of operation and other things. And then eventually the theoretician said, yeah, we got to be paying attention to this too. And people like Phil and others got together too.
Like in late 90s, much later.
Yeah.
I think that one of the issues was that all the theoretical analysis was done on the polynomial versus exponential time. How do you deal with
it's asymptotic complexity as opposed to concrete complexity too? That was another issue that.
With polynomial time, so you needed this concrete security.
Yes, that's a very good point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because the practical schemes are not families; they're just individual ciphers. You know, this is a 64-bit word length or whatever, and you know, it's a thing. You can't.
Which is very particular, not to derail, but it's very particular. The fact that symmetric encryption should be randomized, did people realize it, or was it used in a randomized way, or, I mean...
Symmetric encryption.
Yeah, all this time, right? Because this presumably should call for symmetric and different.
Yeah, yeah. It wasn't really presented as a randomized scheme in the same way with proofs and everything, though. It was just sort of, yeah. Yeah. Yes, you're right. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So we go back and untangle some of that. The history's gotten larger. But the randomization is another conceptual breakthrough. Digital signatures, as I said, was one of the key things that got me interested in public key to begin with. I eventually got together with Shafi and Silvio and proposed some theoretically interesting schemes, which and then clarified the notions of what you mean by security for digital signatures too. Adaptive security against chosen message attack being the sort of the strongest notion where the adversary can play this game and ask for digital signatures of the scheme and then try to come up with a forgery. So the notion of games we've all seen now as another pervasive tool in crypto is just defining carefully what one means by security by setting it up so that an adversary has to play and win a game in a non-trivial manner or non-trivial probability to defeat the security. Very useful notions, which also appeared up here. This is games notions. And earlier, the notion of indistinguishability, which appeared in Turing's work, talking about what intelligence is all about. I just saw Ex Machina the other night too, right? I've seen that, right? So, what does it mean to be intelligent? So the Turing test for intelligence. Although Turing also talked about distinguishing a man from a woman over the teletype, but the notion of indistinguishability as a definition for something is very, very useful. I think that was a great contribution that Turing made to AI, talking about the Turing test for have you achieved AI. You can argue about whether it's the right definition or not, but it's at least a useful and usable definition. And the notion pioneered by Sylvain Chaffee and others on game theoretic, game style definitions for security, I think, again, this is a tremendously useful contribution because security is hard. Security is a negative property. So, the security means the adversary can't do something. So you've got to set up the scenario. So this is what the scenario that the adversary is going to be in. He's told this, he's told that, and this is the game he's going to play. And he wins in this thing. So it's really fits very naturally into this game theoretic framework. So it's a lovely approach. RC4 seems to. So lots of ciphers around. So one of the ones I was involved with was the RC4 cipher, which is still arguably the most widely used stream cipher. Its use is decreasing now rather rapidly as some statistical attacks have been developed against it, but it's still actually reasonably secure. It's not a public key scheme. It's a pseudo-random generator. It generates a sequence of random bytes that get XORed with a message. It's very simple and very fast, which is why it's become popular. It was actually some work I did with RSA, the company, as part of my consulting with them for a while, and it was not a published paper. There was no paper on this for quite a while, and there were reverse engineering versions of this, alleged RC4, ARC4, and things like this. But this is the algorithm right here, right? You have a table of size 256 of bytes. It's a random byte substitution table. Actually, the reason that the design started off with that is not well known. It's the following. So at the time, one of the things that the one worried about was adversaries building special purpose chips to search the key space, right? And so having a cipher for which the state space was so large made it really hard, at least in those days, to implement a search chip. Right? You'd have to have memory off the chip to look up the table and so on, to really slow it down. And so that was one of many motivations to make a large state space. Plus, it's also interesting to see what you can do. A lot of low-end machines were byte-oriented, so this seemed like a natural kind of thing to do. These days, stream ciphers are arguably better implemented using word-oriented arithmetic, 32-byte words, and so on. And there's lots of stream ciphers in that guise as well. But here, you just generate a new byte as follows. You have two pointers, I and J, into the table. I just loops around the table one by one. J pseudo-randomly bounces around, so J gets incremented by S sub I, where I was just incremented. We swap those two, and then we take the sum of those two values we swapped and look that up as in the table, and that's the output. It's a very simple algorithm, and it's not related to any known hard problem. There's no factoring involved or anything like that. There's no assumptions that you're basing on. it's sort of one of those many kinds of crypto primitives that's the bottom of the food chain, right? It is what it is, and it's either okay or it's not, based on, you know, your analysis of that, as I say. But it's not. There's nothing else that you're reducing to it. It's used in SSH. It's widely used. Web, BitTorrent, SSL, Kerberos, PDF, Skype, other places. In part, you know, people like things that are simple. People like things that are fast. But people should also like things that are secure, right? And sometimes those are in conflict. And I tend to think that we have a predilection towards speed in this field, at least in practical terms, that people tend to adopt things just because they're fast, and, you know, a little bit of overkill on terms of the complexity, slow it down a bit, make it more secure is probably fine. You know, the AES contest was won by an algorithm which is pretty fast. Maybe should have had a few more rounds. We'll see. You know, this is a pretty fast algorithm, but this has started to show its weaknesses now. Right? There's been a recent paper at USENIX showing that it's actually, you know, 2^40 outputs to distinguish it from random, which is getting to be practical. It's not a break; it's just a distinguishing from random, and so on. So this is, you know, crypto systems come and go. They have their time, and you learn more about them. They should be retired. This is probably getting to the point where this algorithm should be retired. I spent some time recently with Jacob Schult designing a replacement for RC4 using the same sort of primitives. I mean, as I said, if you want to do a stream cipher today, you might just better use a word-oriented kind of architecture. But if you took the ground rules we had then and say we wanted to design a secure stream cipher that just used a table of size 256, you know, what would you do? So this is an interesting design question. And what we actually did was interesting. We did computer search. So we said, you know, we worry about statistical attacks. We're looking for very slight deviations from uniformity. And so we searched over thousands of different algorithms, you know, for every update of I stays the same, but J updates in various ways. So this was an assignment statement that was found in the context with where you have actually another third registered K gets K plus S of J plus S of I. K gets I plus K plus S of J, and so on. So we swap those two, kept the swap, and then an output is S of J plus S of I plus S of Z plus K. So this was found to be the best in terms of statistical uniformity of the output of all of the thousands of the things that we looked at. And we used many, many core years of computer time to search over these. So this, yeah?
Sorry, I'm just curious. So you said to use statistical test as your criteria?
Yep.
Kind of one of those random long statistical tests, so it was like a very well-defined statistical shock.
So the chi-squared test, basically we took things the adversary would know. So you can take, the adversary knows I because I cycles, the adversary knows the output Z for each step, and you can say, well, let's take I in two consecutive output bytes, say. So you take triples of bytes like that, and you say, let's do a chi-squared test on those three values, and you test that, compare that to uniformity. This got we did lots of tests. We did lots of such tests. So, you know, I and Z and Z plus 2, there's a second one later out, or I and, you know, J and Z, or things like that. So we looked at lots of different tests to try to, you know, you can't be exhaustive, but we tried to do as best we could, sort of scoping out all the different kinds of reasonable things the adversary could try. And this design is very, very faint. It's irregularity. It's got some. So our argument, you know, our tests seem to indicate it takes 2^81 samples before you start seeing any variations from randomness, whereas RC4, as I said, you know, 2^41 seems to be probably done. Yeah, so it's a interesting approach, right? It's computer search for a crypto algorithm, and a lot of statistical testing. We're using the clusters of many core machines at MIT and just having them crunch all the time to run these tests as much as we can. The nice thing about RC4, these designs, is the value n doesn't have to be 256. It could be smaller. It could be 64, 32, 16. So you can test out these smaller versions of the scheme. And if they show statistical irregularities, then you know the bigger ones are likely to be bad too. So we can test out the smaller ones and then scale it up.
So that's how you arrive at 2^81? Is it just by sort of extrapolating based on...
Yes, the... yes, yes, yes. So we can only test it up to n equals 32 or 48, I guess we did actually some. So we extrapolated. But the extrapolation seemed random on a straight line, so I'm confident that that's right for them. But it, you know, we couldn't actually do 2^81 steps with the machines we had. So. There's MD5. So MD5 goes back again. That was 91. One of the things that people discovered as we get into the era of the web and so on, too, is that we need to do a lot of signing of things. Certificates needed to be signed, other things. So you take some file, you hash it. You get, in the case of MD5, a 128-bit signature. It's supposed to be collision resistant. There wasn't much literature on hash functions at the time. Things that maybe you could derive from number theory and so on too were going to be too expensive. So MD5 and MD4, its predecessor, were designs that I came up with, which were word-oriented, so they used 32-bit words and so on too. The MD5 and MD4 designs use four 32-bit words to represent the state in a Merkle-Damgard kind of construction to end up with the output. It's sort of ARX style, which means, you know, the elementary operation of these word operations, addition, sortations, exclusive ORs, maybe ANDs and ORs. And so that's a style of design which has become popular for both crypto systems and hash functions. So they became widely used. I mean, people like things that are fast. This makes signing things a lot faster. Again, security. I was surprised how quickly the uptake was for MD4 and then MD5 as well, in spite of much security analysis. I mean, the NSA will often design an algorithm and spend 10 years evaluating it before they actually put it into practice, right? In the real world, you know, we'll publish something, and if it's fast and it seems to be okay, people will start using it right away. This should have been, you know, evaluated a lot more heavily before it got into wider use. Right. Yeah?
Did you know about, did you know about the extension attack? They think that from one of the algorithms, the suffix, you can compute kind of, something related.
You're talking about using this for a Mac?
For example, for Mac, but yeah. We generally view it as a random oracle. But yeah, did you know about it? And B, if you did, was it by design? Because you wanted to keep the simple operations.
Yeah, the output here is the entire state, right? So that's a bug if you want to use it for something like that, where you want to use it for Mac.
Well, you didn't think about it at the time? I was just curious.
I don't think we thought about it at the time, yeah.
If you think about it with keys, I mean, as a pseudo-random function should have a key, right? This was not the key there.
It was not keyed. Yeah. You're sort of waiting for your work. We'll do that right, you know?
When were the maps introduced?
So there's an old paper by Davies, which might have had some Mac stuff in it. Good question.
I think it is a paper from the 70s.
Yeah.
Computational, not one time, right?
And what year?
So again, here at the bottom of the food chain here, you're sort of designing schemes which are fast enough to be of practical interest, but then you want to have some assurances for security as well. And so that means they're not secure because of reductions. They're secure, you hope, because, you know, smart people can't put a dent in them. That turns out to have been false for this, of course. We'll see, as you may know. We'll see. So at that time, so continuing on with the story, cryptography seemed to be of commercial interest. We founded a company, RSA. There's a patent that MIT had filed for. It's now expired, but it was there for a while. It actually got delayed a little bit in the issuing because there was a back and forth between Stanford and MIT about their patents versus ours and stuff like that, which was actually fine.
Things that happened to RSA, right?
Yeah, it was good, actually. 6 years. Yeah, 6 years was actually a good, the delay was, because there was no business in the first, 83 to 89, there was nothing happening, right, really, in crypto. So the company, starting in 83, this was the business for quite a while. This is what was happening in the crypto business world, right? There was nothing, right? There was no market, really. It seemed like people talked about it, but nothing was really happening. Nobody was paying much for crypto. So the company was living on vapors for a while. Jim Bidzos joined in 86 when the company just about went bankrupt, and was able to negotiate licenses with, at first, Lotus Notes, which was owned by IBM, then Motorola, Apple, and Novell, and Netscape. And so the company sort of just barely crashed and then took off again when Jim took the reins. So he was a very savvy technical guy with a strong sales background, and is now running VeriSign. The company also started the RSA Conference Series in 91. It started off with 60 people down at the Sofitel down in Redwood City. Now it's 20,000 people in the Moscone Center in San Francisco. It's gone maybe 30,000 people. VeriSign was spun out. As I said, Jim's running VeriSign now. Does a lot of certificate checks per day. So VeriSign's a very successful company. And RSA was acquired by Security Dynamics, and which was itself acquired by EMC, so it's part of that family. So another thing happened on the way to today, the World Wide Web. Tim Berners-Lee, in early 90s, invented the World Wide Web, and that, to my mind, was, for crypto, in terms of its impact on crypto, as important as radio. Right, this is a new medium, a new communications medium with its own security needs. It's everywhere now, and again, it's very much like radio. It's not hard to tap into things if you know what you're doing, or your messages are going through parties of unknown trustworthiness. So this again stimulated the growth of cryptography in a way that we hadn't seen, since the turn of the century. Crypto policy. So the policy, I alluded to policy earlier. At the beginning, right, there was the issue of the international traffic in arms regulations, whether one in academia could do research in cryptography without violating some sort of law. You know, could I have a graduate student from overseas and talk to them about crypto? Could I publish papers and so on too? And it turns out that the law, at least the ITAR interpretation, got settled in favor of academic research, and that the ITAR was written in a way that exempted academic research. So that's not a problem. But MIT had a top-ranking committee with John Deutsch, who's ran the CIA for a while, and Mike Tertouzos and others, which issued his own report, strongly in support of academic research. And I think all of us here believe in the importance of academic research to the world as a whole. I think this is a field that we have to understand in order to make our society work the way it should. And so this was the start of the policy debate. In the 90s, the government, so there was a decade of the 80s where things were a little bit quiet. In the 90s, again, the government picked up and said, we're really not happy with the way things are going. We think we ought to be able to read everything that's encrypted, and so everybody ought to be using Clipper chips, which have keys that they know inside them so that they can read all of the traffic. And so that didn't go too well for them, but there was a debate, and the people in favor of strong encryption and personal privacy won that debate, and this idea did not move forward. And it seemed at the time that the crypto wars were then over. Crypto was recognized for being not only important academically, but commercially, to make our businesses, which depend on e-commerce, stronger, and for national security, for our own infrastructure. But this issue has resurfaced recently, right? I mean, just yesterday, Tim Cook from Apple was talking strongly about the importance of strong encryption for business and for protecting consumer privacy. The FBI is making noises about needing to get into anybody's devices whenever they want to. The Patriot Act was just rolled back, and another law rolled in. So policy issues relating to privacy in the digital era are not settled, and I think we all need to play our role in speaking up about the way we feel about these issues.
You should change the seal, Big Brother inside, into Big Brother everywhere.
Yeah, there's a lot of quotes you could use. I mean, the NSA seems to be in favor of, collect everything and look at it when you need it or something. So tax. So remember, we did publish a number back in, how am I doing in time? Okay. Back in 77, in Martin Gardner's column, offering $100 for anybody who could factor this 129-digit number. So that's the number that we published, 114381625, whatever. And
how many bits is it?
It's 129 digits. So multiply by 3.2, whatever. So yeah.
When did you offer that again? That $100.
Oh, it was in 77.
It took a little while.
Right? So it's the cheapest investment in computation time ever, right? Because it was finally factored. I mean, it didn't take 40 quadrillion years like we had estimated. So Derek Atkins, Michael Graff, Arjen Lenstra, Paul Leyland factored it, and you can check this on your smartphone.
You only have to pay out $75 because.
Okay. No, we So it was an interesting effort because it was distributed over the internet. It was a factorization problem, parallelizes nicely. You can farm out various sieving tests to various machines. So by today's standards, maybe this isn't a lot of computation anymore, and the machines that they had available then are much less powerful than what you have now. But 8 months' work, 600 volunteers, 5,000 MIPS years. So a MIPS year is a million instructions per second year. Right, so now we have GIPS years on your computers, because, or whatever you want to call them. So, but that was this, quite a bit. And the secret message, the magic words are squeamish ossifrage. So that was we had a ciphertext in the Scientific American article too. And those last two words we just picked at random out of a dictionary. So I never expected to see those, whatever. So they decoded that, and we actually paid them up. Here's a copy of the check that we gave them for $100. And they printed out the whole big number here. This is part of a long banner that would have gone all the way around this room. And there's Derek and Arian and Paul and Michael.
The award should have been inflation adjusted at least.
Pardon?
It should have been inflation adjusted.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. Yeah.
What did they spend it on?
I have no idea. That's a good question.
Did they cash it or did they frame it?
No, they cashed.
I hear Donald Knuth's checks that he writes when you find bugs in his book. They never get cashed, right? People always frame them. So this came off an MIT account, not my account, so I think or something. some discretionary account. Maybe it was off my account. I don't know if you don't remember. I don't recognize the account number. So factoring. So they broke that. How hard is factoring? So this is the state of factoring numbers in terms of the records that have been set. This is the 129-digit number here, and then we've got a 768-bit number that's been factored. And this up here is the line for 2048-bit numbers. And we don't know where it's going to go. It could be that it won't go down, right? But I mean, this. They just stay like this forever, or maybe it goes shooting up and somebody discovers a polynomial time algorithm. Or maybe it'll just stay here and nobody cares, right? Because people will start using other schemes, elliptic curves and so on too, that don't depend on factoring, and so the issue of factoring becomes a non-issue. Nothing happens here. I think there's a long ways to go to get up here. There's not only algorithmic developments that come into play. Most of these advances are combination of algorithmic developments and increasing computing power and increasing network of the parties cooperating to factor the number. But also there's other things happening down the road, like Peter Shor's algorithm for factoring numbers. So he's proposed in 94, was it? Yes. A factoring algorithm based on the use of qubits to represent information rather than bits. So a qubit is a superposition of a 0 and 1. You can have a machine with lots of qubits representing having very many possible states. I mean, I've tried to teach quantum computing. It's hard. It's hard to think about. But right, it's not just parallelism. There's a superposition of states, and you can then look at that superposition and get a sample of the probability distribution it represents. And it turns out what it's particularly good at is finding periods. So you can find the period of a periodic function. And that's precisely what you need for breaking things like RSA or Elgamal and other things which have a cyclic group as their underlying structure, because the period of the cyclic group is what you want. So Peter showed that using a quantum computer, you could factor numbers in polynomial time. And it may be the case that we can build these things. Don't know, all right? I mean, I have my biases, of course. I would prefer that they never be built. But, people seem determined to try, even after the fact that, once you build one, what are you going to do with it? People won't be using RSA anymore at that point.
Alice and Bob would be there.
Pardon?
Alice and Bob would still be there.
So Alice and Bob would still be there, yeah, right. Originally it seemed, the progress was about starting off very slow. I mean, they built a machine with a few qubits and factored 15, which seems sort of laughably small. But then, more recently things have gotten better. I looked at the web just last night to see what's the latest record. I hadn't seen this one. It was coming 2014, which is 291.311. equals 557 times 523. This is wasn't a general purpose factoring algorithm quite, so it's not clear quite what the things. And they only used 4 qubits, so the numbers had to be a special form to be able to factor it. But it was still a quantum factoring effort. So we'll see where it goes. Some people tend to be optimistic that we can build these large things. Other people, like Ross Anderson's involved with an interesting effort at Cambridge, where the fellow's studying the foundations of quantum computing. He sort of has reasons to think that quantum computing may never be possible for fundamental reasons. But the proof is in the pudding, of course, and we'll see what happens. I think it'll take a while before we get there. In the meantime, it's good. I like seeing all these conferences labeled post-quantum cryptography and things like this. I think it's good things. We need to be prepared for the worst case and be prepared to have crypto algorithms that are usable in case all of this stuff based on cyclic groups and so on too falls apart. Besides, it's academically interesting and practically interesting possibly as well. So maybe dark clouds on the horizon for RSA. Possibly. We'll see. Hash function attacks. So remember MD5, so we said there's a scheme which should be collision resistant. Well, Xiaoyan Wang, who's shown here, is now at Tsinghua University. I think she's still there. And colleagues found a way to produce collisions for MD5. Very clever, very detailed attack, sort of a differential analysis on that, using techniques that didn't exist at the time MD5 was invented. It's now very easy to come up with collisions for MD5. So finding two files that have the same hash. So MD5 is definitely something you don't want to be using any place where collision resistance is a property. Maybe if it's for a pseudo-random generator or something, it's fine. But if you want collision resistance, you shouldn't be using MD5 anymore. So a brilliant breakthrough there. No $100 to give out. We didn't offer prizes for that.
Any evidence U.S. or Chinese government knew about it before? We don't know one way or the other. RSA or other things, you're saying differential cryptanalysis they knew before. This one, we don't have any evidence.
So I have no evidence. I have no nothing. I don't have a security clearance, so I don't know anything about what the NSA knows, except what they make public, which is nothing. Or Snowden reveals, right? The Chinese government. I have no idea. So
So Shawan is actually, there is no collision yet. For Shawan, there is a collision yet.
There's it seems doable with enough computing power, but nobody's actually given a demo yet. But it's so we have a... So NIST got very nervous about this and said not only SHA-1, but maybe the SHA-2 family of hash functions, what they had standardized, it seemed like they might be vulnerable. Said we need a backup, sort of a prudent thing to do. They ran another contest for SHA-3, and which was adopted as Ketchik. So we had MIT, we had another submission, MD6, and many other, some of the folks here had other submissions. So there's a number of candidates for good hash functions out there. Ketchik's is a very interesting one. It's got the sponge function design, as it's called. I won't say more about that, but that's a nice design. So I think probably for the near future, people will be using SHA-2. SHA-256 is a member of that family. And so we learned. But again, there's no reduction here from a hard problem, although Ketchik has got some basis for optimism that it'll be around for quite a while. Other directions, so the field is exploding. This workshop this summer is a great illustration of that. All the different things you can find to work on: secret sharing, anonymity, commitments, multi-party protocols, elliptic curves, crypto hardware, key leakage, proxy encryption, smart cards, password-based keys, random oracles, oblivious transfer, zero-knowledge proofs, payment systems, voting systems, homomorphic encryption, lattice-based crypto, private information retrieval, public key infrastructure, concurrent protocols, randomness extractors, tweakable encryption, differential cryptanalysis, identity-based encryption, and so on and so on. I'm sorry if I didn't list your favorite topics. In the public view, crypto is still just about encryption, but there's really so much more going on. It's a wonderful field, and I'll say a little bit about these, which you mostly may know about here, at least those of you here: zero-knowledge proofs, payment systems, voting systems, homomorphic encryption. Zero-knowledge proofs is one of my favorite parts of the field. I think it's just lovely technology for showing somebody you know something without telling them what it is you know. Right? So I can convince you I know a solution to a hard problem, like factoring or satisfiability, while telling you nothing about the solution, even if you're very skeptical. So nice work by Shafi and Silvio and Charlie Rakoff and Oded and Silvio and Avi. I think it's just marvelous technology. Lots of applications for this stuff. We're seeing more and more as time goes on. I remember when Silvio first came around to tell me about these, I said, Silvio, it's great ideas, but the name, I just don't like zero knowledge proofs. It just seems wrong somehow. That'll never catch on. You know, I was wrong about that. The technology is so wonderful. I think whatever you call it, it's going to catch on. So Sylvia and I spent some time with payment systems. Payment systems have gotten big recently with Bitcoin. Sylvia and I tried to enter the payment systems market a bit in 2001. We had an idea for probabilistic payments, which appealed to mathematicians at least. So it says if I want to pay you 10 cents, what that really means, I'll just pay you a dollar with a probability 1 in 10. So I'll turn all micropayments into macropayments, right? And we flip coins by using pseudo-random digital signatures. So the recipient signs it, and that is the bits, lower bits of his signature form the coins that determine whether it's a macro payment or a micro payment. So when he countersigns it. And so fun ideas, but we could never really get the company to go too far. And so we sold it off, what was left of the company in 2007. Who knows, this may still go with it. Silvio still has some interest in seeing that technology move forward, but I think it's hard to compete with Bitcoin these days. And then one of the big differences in terms of the market, if you're thinking about payment systems, I think this one of the reasons this didn't work is we couldn't get Visa and MasterCard to cooperate nicely with us, whereas Bitcoin doesn't require third parties to play ball. It just sort of is a decentralized system that anybody can join, no matter how, without the trusted third parties. So. Voting systems. I spend quite a bit of time these days talking about voting and voting research, and there's been a lot of progress on voting. Cryptography plays a key role there. Some of the end-to-end crypto systems by Chaum and others have the property that all ballots get posted on the web, so you vote and your vote ends up on the web, but you don't want people to be able to sell their votes, so the votes have to be encrypted. And then you've got a couple of problems to solve given that they're encrypted, which is how does the voter know it's really encrypting her vote and not something else? So you have to have a protocol for voting that allows the voter to satisfy herself that the vote is correctly encrypted. And then you've got all these encrypted votes on the web and somebody claims that that's the answer. How do you come up with the answer in a way that's credible as well? So these are some paper ballots in addition to the electronics. So cryptography can be used in some sense to increase the transparency and increase the verifiability of what's going on in nice ways. And I think that's a great direction. In fact, we've just seen today, or maybe it was yesterday, the city of Austin, Texas release a request for proposals on their voting system called StarVote, which goes in this direction. And they're actually going to be building a new system because they can't get this kind of stuff from the vendors, or at least not yet. And so they'll be... So that seems to be making good progress. Fully homomorphic encryption, you've heard some about that already, right? So back in 78, Mike Dertouzos, who was head of our lab for computer science then, in discussion with Len and I, we asked, can you compute and encrypt the data? And so at the time, we didn't see how to do that at all. And if you read our paper, it sort of has a negative sort of feeling to it. Yeah, probably not, but maybe. And then Craig Gentry had a breakthrough with lattice-based approaches to fully homomorphic encryption. So this is quite exciting. I mean, it's nice that you can actually do things on encrypted data in a way that does the corresponding operations on the plain text. Starting to get practical. So many of you here are working on this stuff, and I've been very pleased to see how much progress has been made on getting this towards practice. It's a fascinating area.
The last time someone gave a talk, it was a picture of a baseball player. There was apparently no picture of Craig Gentry on the internet.
No, it was a picture.
Where did I get that picture?
Yeah, but you cannot find the picture of Craig Gentry.
You just find the baseball player first.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't recall where I got this picture. I didn't take it myself, probably. I probably found it on the web. Yeah. So. Anyway, what next? So... I think we're seeing crypto is a wonderful field because the theory lays the foundations, and then you can take the theory and make sure the algorithms are fast enough and make it practical. I think there's about a 20-year lag, though, I think, from the publication of the first paper to the implementation in practice. So you wait for the patents to expire, and you wait for things like that to have the technology to mature. So if you want to implement something, look 20 years ago to see what was hot, and get your students implementing it. Right. So I think that's multi-party computation, I think, is maybe about right. Is factoring really hard? Maybe it's easy. We'll see. I think we're making a lot of assumptions these days in our crypto. Kristen Lauder just had a nice article about assumptions in one of the ACM journals. We're making a lot of assumptions which are poorly studied. Maybe they're true, but you know, we really need better. You know, it's nice to know what you can do with them. You know, it's sort of wishful thing. If this assumption were true, then we could do this. But you know, what reason do you have to believe that this assumption is true or not? How many people have spent serious time trying to break those assumptions? So we need to spend more time on that. Of course, we need to show P is different than NP. Is quantum computing practical? Give Alice and Bob smartphones. So you know, people are not digital computers. We work through agents. The agents these days are always the smartphones. They are representative in the digital infrastructure. And they themselves are not terribly trustworthy. So we have to figure out to live in a world where your agent is only partially trustworthy. And I think we need to think through the trust ecosystem with smartphones a little better than we have. Ground crypto practice better in vulnerable computer systems is part of what I was saying. Prepare better for worst case scenarios. I think the more we see security systems over time, the more we realize how fragile they are and how often they get broken, and the more the adversaries gear up for breaking them on a continuing basis. And so I think we need, in the crypto academic world, we need to be prepared for continual failure, continual breaking of our assumptions. We assume that Alice and Bob can keep secrets. That's a bad assumption today in most contexts. So we really assume that secrets get lost routinely. What do you do in a world like that? So conclusions, cryptography is not the solution to all of our problems, but it's an important component. Research in this area is a wonderful area for doing research, a nice blend of lots of things, math, statistics, theoretical computer science, double E, psychology. So they've done a lot. There's lots and lots more to do. That's why this workshop is so wonderful. Like Alice and Bob, crypto's here to stay. And it's lots of fun, too. So thanks. If there's questions, I'm happy to take any questions. I think I've run off my allotted time. Yes, Chris.
So the way crypto works 2.0, or the things you're hearing, politicians and agency people saying these days, how is it the same or different from what you heard in the early 90s?
One thing that's changed is what they're asking for. Back then, they were saying, we want access to the keys. Now they're saying, we just want access to the plain text. That's one thing that's changed. Another thing that's changed is back then it was primarily about domestic policy. And today I think any kind of policy that you take has to be understood in an international context. Because if you start putting backdoors in for the US government, you're going to need backdoors in for the British and the French and the Germans and the Israelis and the Iranians and the North Koreans. You know, everybody ends up having a piece of the pie there, and then you have no security whatsoever. So I think that's a big change too. Plus, I think we have a better understanding of the fragility of security systems. And when you start putting, because we've had a lot of experience now with just things breaking because they're poorly implemented or left turned on. We've seen some recent cases where options were left turned on in a way that is practically, you know, debug equals on kind of thing left on for too long. Security tweaks are just not providing any help whatsoever. They're intended to provide law enforcement some access at one time, like the export options. What else has changed?
Was it worth the motivation? I mean, today it's terrorists. What was it in the 90s?
So terrorism gets waved around a lot today. I actually am not totally convinced by those arguments that it's terrorism today. It's waved around because it's convenient politically. I think there's a lot of people that are just sort of drunk on the power of total surveillance. You build a society in which they don't want to be caught in a situation where they maybe could have done something technically, and they couldn't because it was not allowed. So they take the attitude of collecting everything and having it available just in case. But the evidence so far is that this stuff is largely useless. There's just too much of it, and there's no way there's no terrorism cases that have been hampered by this, and so it's. I think you get in that kind of position where you're collecting everything. You say, "Oh, this is so much fun. We can buy all the stuff we can access, and so on too." But I think there's the potential for huge amounts of abuse. There's a tremendous lack of oversight in this stuff. So I think it's really, as a society, something to worry about is to have that kind of surveillance apparatus built into the basic digital infrastructure. There are real issues there with terrorism and so on, too, but I'm not convinced that this is the right policy to help address it. I think in large terms, the accessibility of information about what people are doing, in any case, even with good encryption, is so much better for law enforcement than it used to be. Right? Now, so much of our lives are recorded by other third parties, the credit card companies and other things and so on. But I think closing off some aspects of it is not a big hit for them. Yes, in the back.
You mentioned a few times that you were more interested in digital signatures as kind of the first application more than encryption. Why?
Because I hadn't seen them before. They were new to me. They were exciting. I said, this is cool. You know, encryption I've heard about, you know, DES was out there and stuff like that. But digital signatures, oh, yeah, that's really, really different and neat. So, plus, they seem like really useful. Yeah.
Isn't it the case that the government would lose the battle about the data, the actual text, because any terrorist who wants to encrypt will download something in addition to whatever the phone is offering?
So I think... Yeah, so the question was whether these kinds of restrictions are ultimately useless. It's certainly the case that smart terrorists could download other things that would help them protect their data. And I guess so the government's basically arguing, well, there's enough dumb terrorists to make this worth our while. And that's to be seen. I mean, you know, things get packaged up and more useful for anybody, even dumb people, to use. So, yeah.
I'm Cynthia's voice. What evidence do we have, or do you know of any evidence for the abuse of this kind of global surveillance, collected data, or mission creep?
Well, I mean, I think the Snowden revelations are the biggest thing recently on that. So it's all of the existence of the kind of pervasive surveillance that we've seen. I think I'm answering your question. I'm sorry you can't talk.
Did you hear the question? So do you know of a specific example of bad stuff that was done with it? I mean, it sounds awful, but do you know of a specific example of a particular
Not just the collection, but acting on the collected data, I think, is what's
interesting. For the purposes of defeating terrorism or the purposes of just abuse? You hear rumors about people who are... Yeah, I mean, Snowden, I think, talked about some of these things where people who have access to these massive databases, you know, will look at what their wives are up to or things like this or other things. And so I don't have access to that. I don't know any more than what's been in the press about this, so I don't have anything I can tell you that you can't read elsewhere. There's the potential for abuse. It may be the case that in this country there's less abuse than there would be in other countries, could this kind of things. But it's certainly the case that the U.S., whatever it does, will set a precedent for other countries. And so you'll see surveillance apparatuses established routinely without any apologies worldwide if the U.S. starts doing it here to that extent. Sorry, I don't have better examples. Yeah.
So, I mean, this is like a standard, I guess, questions that they hear from security people. I'm just curious how you answer this relatively standard question. So it's kind of like, well, crypto is really cool, but essentially anything that has pretty much ever been broken of any significance hasn't been broken because of crypto, but of something else. So in some sense, you kind of solved the basic important thing. So all, let's say, finding and other stuff should be invested outside of crypto because you guys are more or less too good, ready for your own good.
So, you know, to some extent that's right, right? I mean, crypto succeeds when the weakest link is somewhere else.
Right.
And we've seen lots of cases where the weakest link is indeed somewhere else. So I think there's definitely a need for lots of research and development to go on non-crypto kinds of security things. I mean, we are doing a lot of our crypto research and things as sort of in a fantasy world where Alice can keep a secret and can generate random numbers that are really random. Bob can generate random keys too and can keep his secrets. And those basic assumptions are not so well founded in the real world. So there's a lot to be done to allow real people who are using electronic agents to represent them to carry, to substantiate those assumptions, right? So those agents have to be trustworthy. They have to be able to keep secrets. They have to be able to generate random numbers as a basic thing. So these are all hard things. And I would not argue with a security agenda that said we need to do not only crypto security, but we need to do system security in a very strong manner. I think, and we're starting to see lots more response of this sort too. But there's so many layers of history and old systems out there and stuff like that. So a lot of the stuff is just a matter of cleaning up what we've done badly before. But there's also a need for fundamental work on building systems that cryptographers can use appropriately too. Yes.
Going back to the early 70s, the late 70s and 80s, and this issue of munitions and arms, yep, export control and stuff, I guess I'm curious about this trade in exploits. You know, there's kind of this dark market out there where you can buy software that's designed to penetrate systems. The government buys some of it for, yep, surveillance
purposes. Yeah, 0 days and stuff like this, yes.
0 days, but you can also maybe sell it to other people who may have bad intentions as well. And it seems like that system of regulation may be something that people will try to come back to and say, these are weapons, these 0 days, these exploits are weapons. And I'm curious about your thoughts on the public policy implications of either regulating or not regulating 0 days or software or ideas, because obviously, you know, when
you don't want to have people,
it was kind of like, you know, let's not do that because we're impeding the ability to have knowledge be used, because we're calling it, you know, military systems when it's really,
it's not just the sale, it's also the research, right? I mean, it's, yeah, a chilling effect you can have on people looking for bugs
in a way, yeah, because, you know, if you regulate a 0 day exploit, essentially what you're saying is, I discovered this flaw and this vulnerability, now I want to publish it, now I want to create a software program about it, now I want to sell it to somebody. You know, does the government have the right to come in and say, no, that's essentially the equivalent of creating a bomb and we're going to regulate you somehow?
Yeah, I don't know about those kinds of equivalence arguments. I think that, you know, cybersecurity, but you're right. I mean,
I
haven't thought about these much.
I mean, I've discovered the exploit that's going to take down, you know, our critical infrastructure, and I want to publish it, or I want to sell it to some party that might be using it for bad reasons. Is there a balance there of whether that should be freely allowed or whether we should somehow regulate it?
So I guess I tend to favor at this point an informal responsible disclosure policy where there's no firm regulations. I mean, I have this issue come up in my class where students I tell them I want them to teach a security class. I say, you're going to do a final project. It should be about security. It should be interesting. And those are the only requirements. But if you're looking at vulnerabilities, you also have to do responsible disclosure. And so this happens every year. They find some bugs and some fielded product. I insist that they, you know, A, get permission from the company ahead of time before they look for these vulnerabilities, and B, that they'd go through a responsible disclosure procedure before we post their paper on the class website. So the and I think that's the style of thing I would prefer to see. You know, I think it's premature to talk about regulation because that would, I think, have a chilling effect on a lot of important stuff that needs to be done. The only people looking for vulnerabilities then would be the people that have bad intent.
Let's take the rest of the questions offline.
Thank you. Thank you.